Penguin Random House Audio presents Scorpion by Christian Cantrell. Read for you by Hilary Huber. Prologue. Henrietta Yee and her team have been underground for 3 days. They are over 150 meters down, directly beneath the France-Switzerland border, collectively leaning into the glow of a slab of black plasma glass. The green rectangular cursor at the top blinks, but the eyes transfixed by its promise of results do not. From the moment it was switched on, the Large Hadron Collider collected far more raw data than researchers could possibly process, so the vast majority went straight into the Particle Detector Backlog, or PDB. Cold storage, as it was sometimes called. As part of Henrietta's thesis research, she is leading the team tasked with thawing it out, slicing it up, and feeding it to a voracious AI painstakingly trained to identify quantum anomalies. The theory is that there may be previously undiscovered signals buried beneath all those years of noise. Exactly what meaning those signals may carry, nobody knows. Some of her peers hope to clinch their PhDs by certifying the theory of supersymmetry. Others hope to be the very first to glimpse the multiverse. A few even believe it is possible that they will discover an entirely new particle, infinitesimal units of mass with such novel characteristics that the world will be forced to rewrite the rules of physics. Henrietta's dreams are no less ambitious. Her father was killed in the nuclear attack on Seoul, leaving his relentless pursuit of a Nobel Prize to his only child. Henrietta has dedicated her life to academia, turning down multiple offers from the private sector, packages of obscene salaries, perks, and stock options, all for the opportunity to work underground and to be exactly where she is right now. When the first few rows of hexadecimal data finally appear, the room erupts. There are hugs and high fives behind her, but Henrietta remains focused. And then something in the data changes, and the celebration abates. Fingers enter Henrietta's peripheral vision from all around. "That's an encryption header," someone says behind her. "That's AES encryption, isn't it? And look, it's repeating like a blockchain." The characters are not appearing sequentially, but erratically, sometimes incorrectly decoded, then overwritten moments later. But something about the content at the top feels different. It is not a dribble of incomprehensible bits, but two distinct lines of text. "Look at that. That's not binary. I think that might be..." Several of the letters are shuffled and replaced, and then the cursor jumps to a different location, the algorithm seemingly content with its predictive composition. "We know what we are, but know not what we may be." "This doesn't make any sense. Why would there be text in the particle detector backlog? Where the hell is all this coming from?" Henrietta resets her big round specs and squints in concentration. She goes over it in her mind several more times. The room has grown so quiet that she can hear the high-frequency whine of excited plasma glass as data continues streaming by. "Not where," she finally says, as much to herself as to her team. "When?" Part 1. Chapter 1. Agent of Chaos. The first thing Kira does before she gets up is put on her legs. They balance on an inductive charging mat beside her bed between a set of steel rails, and the muscles in the young woman's back and shoulders flare as she elevates herself. The nerve terminals in her thighs magnetically align to the pin jacks at the bottom of the carbon fiber cups, and the interfaces constrict until they are securely attached. She has skins somewhere she can roll up over them, And if she were to conceal the seams where the texture-etched urethane and her tissue meet with shorts or a tight skirt, the looks she would get on the street would be of lust and envy rather than curiosity, revulsion, or pity. But Kira lives alone, so the servo-mechanical guts remain exposed, and she does not even bother dressing beyond underwear, a tank top, and her aviator-style metaspecs. She has not left the penthouse suite asylum at the top of the twisted and slowly rotating Infinity Moscow Tower in nearly 4 years. No good reason to even brush her teeth or to close the master bathroom door while she pees. Kira works nights. Her workstation is her studio, and her tools are instruments of fabrication and conspiracy. Proxies conceal her real IP and map to her many identities. Location can be cloaked from the outside world, but real-time interaction cannot be forged, so Kira has become nocturnal. Her boss calls her a change agent, but she knows that's simply a way of distorting the truth. She is an agent of chaos. The first step in her evening routine is to make herself tea. In the kitchen, she activates the kettle, and while she waits for it to boil, she sits down to flash charge the monitor affixed to her wrist. The device cannot be removed, so it must be replenished in place. She interweaves her fingers and leans forward, both arms flat against the mat. A lightning bolt icon appears in the corner of her vision, indicating that her glasses are receiving an ambient trickle charge conveyed through her biomagnetic field. The charging mat is infused with stacks of overlapping coils that are meant to get warm but never hot, and it is not until she smells something caustic and hears an electrical pop that she is on her feet and her legs are backing her away, and she understands that she's been burned. She kicks the cord out of the wall, turns to the sink, and runs her arm beneath a cold stream. She can already see round red welts forming on the inside of her forearm. It hurts, but she is no stranger to pain. Pain is always with her, and she has learned to observe it from a distance rather than letting it in. Kira was her family's primary source of income before the missiles hit, and her parents had her back in front of a computer before she was even out of the hospital. At home, her father carried her back and forth between her desk and the toilet, and her mother changed her bandages and brought her soup and bathed her, and they never spoke of the retaliatory attack her work provoked. It was in the past, and the past could not be changed. Kira learned from an early age that some people do not have the luxury of indulging in yesterday's fears or even today's chronic pain. If any of her personal monitoring systems fail, she is supposed to alert her handlers immediately. Fuck them, she thinks. They refuse to use anything that is not Russian-made, which means half of it is trash. The other half has shit firmware that any script kiddie could hack. They will know her charger is fried when her monitor runs dry and her biometrics suddenly drop offline. Kira slides the patio door open to help get rid of the smell. Usually, she does not check the pigeons until her tea is steeping, but tonight she steps outside into the cold Moscow evening. Once a day, a bird arrives with a new handwritten encryption key wrapped around its leg. Homing pigeons are supposed to be only one way. Once they have established a specific loft as their home, they will deliver messages only in that one direction. To use them again, they must be collected and redistributed. But these pigeons have been genetically engineered to have bifurcated brains with dominance that toggles according to light. They fly in one direction during the day and the opposite direction at night. Like Kira, their handlers have learned to turn their multiple identities into weapons deployed against their many enemies. Tonight's bird has not yet arrived, but the night air feels good, so Kira does not go back inside. She can feel the spring in the silicone tiles as she passes the pigeon loft, and she gently places her injured arm against the cold metal of the rail and looks out over the city. She is chilly, but not as cold as she would have been in the past. Legs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.